Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and by other public television stations.
Last November, Senator Charles Mathias of Maryland addressed a letter to the chairman of the Republican National Committee, Bill Brock. The letter, which bore the signature not only of Senator Mathias, but of nine other liberal Republican senators, complained of a movement by Republican conservatives to oppose the renomination of Republican liberals. In fact, Senator Mathias spoke darkly of hit lists, implying that particular Republicans had been signaled out for liquidation in the Republican primaries. Senator Mathias himself had been recently humiliated. He stood to inherit the ranking minority position on the Judiciary Committee, but was preempted by Senator Thurmond, who, seeing what otherwise would happen, moved himself over from the Armed Services Committee in time to save the United States from his colleague, Senator Mathias. Charles Mathias was born in Frederick, Maryland, where he went to school, matriculating in due course at Haverford College. There he was interrupted by the war and sent to Yale University on the Naval Officers Program. After serving the Navy, he entered the law school at the University of Maryland. He became an assistant attorney general, then ran for Congress, was reelected three times, and won his Senate seat in 1968. He has always run with great support from state Democrats, and indeed he has a standing invitation to cross the aisle and run in 1980 as a Democrat, an option he has not finally closed the door upon. The examiner, who will be introduced at greater length later, is Mr. Charles Cordray of the Baltimore Sun. I should like to discuss with Senator Mathias the whole question of ideological purity in political parties. We might begin with Senator Mathias's refusal to endorse Senator Goldwater, his party's nominee, in 1964. What happened to your ecumenical impulses on that occasion?
I was very ecumenical. I endorsed Senator Goldwater, and I voted for Senator Goldwater in 1964.
That's when you took advantage of the secret ballot.
No, I made it publicly clear at that time. And I recall very vividly that 64 campaign. It was a tough campaign. It was a very tough campaign in Maryland because Senator Goldwater lost Maryland by a very heavy majority. And in 1964, my own plurality was cut in half from what it had been in the 1962 congressional elections. But notwithstanding, I publicly endorsed the Republican ticket and will now unveil the fact that in the secret ballot, I did vote for Senator Goldwater.
You say you will now unveil because you had kept it a secret up until now?
No, I've never made any bones about it, and Senator Goldwater knows it insofar as one can know those things.
Mm-hmm. Well, the long biographical note on you in the History of American Biography stresses that during your campaign, you made a formalistic declaration binding yourself to your choice of the party's designee, but that in the course of the campaign, assuming this biographer is correct, you did not once mention the name of Senator Goldwater. Now, incidentally, I'm probably sounding more censorious than I mean to be.
Well, let me say...
Because I would not, for instance, have mentioned the name of Senator Javits or Mr. Rockefeller enthusiastically under reversed circumstances, but I'm not a successful politician and you are, so that what you do is much more interesting.
Well, let me say that I did not follow the precedent of our mutual friend Catherine St. George, the very distinguished congresswoman from Tuxedo Park, New York, who at every campaign rally had a little tripod carried out onto the stage and Senator Goldwater's picture placed beside her as she spoke.
She lost too.
She lost. I did make it clear that I would support the party's nominee, and I did so.
Because that was really an act of disciplinary docility, wasn't it? It was as though you were a seminarian bound to accept the infallibility of the Pope, and simply doing so to show the extent of your philosophical consistency.
Well, I have, again, never made any bones about the fact that I think candidates have to take personal positions on issues. Mm-hmm. Now, you recall, if you want to go back to the ancient history of 1964, that was the year in which Senator Goldwater talked about sawing off the East Coast and letting it float out to sea. And mm-hmm. the state of Maryland, in which I was a candidate, was on the East Coast.
Barely.
And it was not a...
That's why you were a rebel state.
It was not a... position that was popular in Maryland. That was the year in which there was talk about the dismantling of Social Security, or at the very least making it a voluntary system.
Was that the year
that
in which Wallace won
the
Democratic
system.
Primary? Or was that 2 years later? 4 years later?
That was the year in which he didn't win it, but came very close
that
to winning
year.
It in Maryland, yes.
Well, Maryland is certainly a confusing state, given these cross
Not
trends.
Confusing. A state of great diversity. A state which reflects many of the currents that are visible elsewhere in the country.
Well, but it is true that we are engaged in a protracted debate in which you figure very prominently on a division that I think was the most scientifically identified by Lenin when he spoke of the twin temptations of sectarianism on the one hand and opportunism on the other. He meant by the sin of sectarianism someone who insisted on such manifestations of ideological purity as to exclude anyone whose ideological inflections were in any sense different from one's own. And by opportunism, he meant people who were dumb enough to embrace a social democracy, for instance, as genuinely Marxist. Now, this comes up again and again where the Republican Party is concerned. On the one hand, the so-called opportunists, using Lenin's phraseology, want to increase the fold and desire a sort of a Mathias approach of forgiveness, if you like, towards people who, though Republicans, vote rather consistently with the Democrats. At the other end are the sectarians who feel that unless you vote with Bill Loeb on every issue, you really don't deserve to be a Republican. Now, let me ask you this. Historically speaking, do you think that the sectarians have made headway since the times of FDR, when nobody considered it in any sense strange that Cotton Ed Smith and Henry Wallace should both be backers of FDR?
I think very clearly the sectarians have made a lot of progress since that time.
Is progress the right word for it?
Well,
advances.
They have advanced their cause. Mm-hmm. And I think the Republican Party is poorer for it. I think the country is poorer for it because I think it has lowered the level of two-party competition, which is basically healthy in our system. And I think one of the costs we're paying for it is that we are drifting toward what is, for all practical purposes, a one-party country.
Yeah, but how do you have competition if there is no ideological distinction?
Well, I think you should have some ideological distinction, but that can be within as well as between the parties. And that has been the historical pattern in America. It was the historical pattern within the Republican Party. Going back a little beyond Lenin to Lincoln, Lincoln recruited the Republican Party from a very desperate kind of political scene in which you had abolitionists and you had conservatives, you had all sorts of different American groups that he brought together on the concept of freedom, on the concept of human rights, if you like, in the modern sense.
Certainly not in the modern sense, excuse me. Well, he didn't believe in human rights for Negroes, for instance.
Well, he believed in freedom, which is one human right.
He believed
right.
in metaphysical equality.
One human right.
Yeah.
And he was able to bring about a coalition of people who had otherwise very differing views. And within that coalition, there were very hot debates. There were discussions. Just a few years after Lincoln's death, you had people bolting the party and abandoning the ticket in the election of 72, I guess. So this kind of debate isn't new to the Republican Party, but what I think is new to the Republican Party is saying that because this kind of debate and difference of opinion exists, you have to go. You're no longer fit to be a Republican. And that has cost us very dearly, to the point that we are now down to only something like 18% of the national electorate.
No, that may not be what cost us that, Senator. There are people who feel that the reason the Republican Party is so universally disdained is that it has lost its identity and perhaps even its persona. I don't have to remind you that under General Eisenhower, over a period of 8 years, we simply decimated our congressional ranks. One would have thought that he'd have been the ideal ecumenist, bringing in Democrats by the tens of millions. In point of fact, the Republican Party continued to recede steadily during the entire time of his tenure. So a lot of people say, well, why did that happen? What the reason why, as advanced by some people, for instance, Clare Booth Lewis, is that the Republican Party lost its imagination and lost its self-confidence. Now, Lincoln may be a bad guy to start out with because Lincoln was so terribly eclectic and at the same time so terribly expedientiary, as he wrote in his famous letter, I want to save the Union and everything else is derivative. It would be extremely difficult to write, I think, a consistent set of philosophical principles based on the declarations mm-hmm. of Abraham Lincoln, which is why you had things like the Abraham Lincoln Brigade going over to help the communists.
But Lincoln may be a hard man to start with, but in fact he is the man we start with.
He was the first Republican president, but he didn't found the Republican Party.
But he brought it to power, and he showed how it could come to power and how it could perform. And I think these are the questions that are before us today. How can you come to power, and how can you perform creditably once you've got power?
Well, the trouble is, in the first place, you're dealing with a genius. And it's extremely hard to describe how to evolve workaday organizations based on a genius. I mean, it's like saying, go to New York and start a school based on Plato's Academy.
But isn't that the whole purpose of a political organization? That how do you carry on in the absence of a genius, of a charismatic leader of Lincoln's quality?
Well, I think that the Republicans can look to Lincoln with great pride, but they have to look to Adam very selectively. After all, here is somebody who, addressing the black population of America, said, I want you to know one thing, that you will never, ever be equal to the white person in the United States. Now, this is not something we want to resurrect on Lincoln's Day oratorical celebrations, is it? So therefore, we have to winnow our way through Lincoln's opera before we decide what themes to stress.
I think that's obviously true with any historical character.
Sure.
George Washington and Thomas Jefferson,
sure,
with their great respect for human dignity, both were slave owners.
Yeah.
So I don't think that these are insuperable problems.
Well, they're not insuperable, but they certainly show that that there is a limited use in pointing to a particular person as the arbiter elegantiae of current ideology. It seems to me that the Republican Party has a clear mission today, and that is to resist the overweening growth of the public sector. Now, let me ask you this. Do you believe that under certain circumstances, people go too far in the direction of the opposition, and that therefore it would inure to the benefit of the democratic process to defeat them, or to, if you like, excrete them? Take John Lindsay. Now, John Lindsay finally decided himself to become a Democrat, but would it have been unpatriotic to have pushed him if you had been, let's say, a Republican of influence in New York City?
Pushed him in what direction?
Towards the Democrats, where he belonged.
Yeah, no, I don't think that.
Because Republican Party to the left wing of the Democratic Party.
I think it was a matter of regret, personally, that John Lindsay left the Republican Party.
Regret to whom?
Regret to me.
Why?
I think he presented a point of view. He kept the spectrum wide in the Republican Party.
He was an incumbent mayor and beaten by an unknown in a Republican primary.
Well, I think he offered within the Republican Party nationally a spectrum of views. And I think that's the point that you take from Lincoln, not what you may pull out here and there from Lincoln's personal experience, but the fact that Lincoln saw the benefit of a variety of views, of a wide spectrum of views. And I think we...
Are you saying Democrats don't?
Well, they enjoy it, obviously. I have...
Well, then what's the difference?
Our colleagues...
What are you saying that distinguishes between Republicans
and
Democrats?
One of the reasons the Democrats are successful in a great, broadly geographic country of this sort, with a variety, of climate, a variety of society. Mm-hmm. My good friend and colleague and chairman, Jim Eastland from Mississippi, mm-hmm, sits very comfortably beside Ted Kennedy. They don't agree on everything, but they don't make that disagreement the reason for either one of them saying you don't belong in the Democratic Party.
Well, Teddy Kennedy went down and visited George Wallace and treated him like John the Baptist sometime after Chappaquiddick. Maybe he thought that he could have been shrived by George Wallace baptismally. The fact of the matter is that these are professional politicians, and if you want to advance in American politics, you don't go down and insult Jim Eastland, and you don't go down and insult George Wallace anymore.
That's right, and you don't.
It's not even safe to do
that. And you don't go into another fellow's state and say you don't belong in the Republican Party. You should get out.
Well, but you started off.
And yet, that is what's happening in our party today.
Uh-huh. But you started off by saying that the essence of our system is that there should be a competitive relationship between the major parties. I'm asking, how can there be a competitive relationship if there can be no identification of someone who is?
Because I think that
if John Lindsay is a Republican, then it becomes incoherent.
Well, I served with John Lindsay in the House of Representatives.
And survived.
On the Judiciary Committee, I saw his very heated debates, for example, with more conservative Republicans. I think that out of those debates developed a more coherent and a more positive Republican position. For example, I'll give you one example. Bill McCulloch of Ohio, a Republican, Midwestern Republican, representing 20 or 30 years of service in the House as an Ohio Republican, who are not normally noted for their liberal tendencies, debated John, and together the three of us finally introduced the first civil rights legislation, which started the great legislative movement towards civil rights of the 1960s. It wasn't the Kennedy bill. It was that bill which started among Republicans of different ideological persuasions who developed a civil rights position which really meant something, and which finally forced the Kennedy administration to come along later and support a civil rights bill that had enormous consequences for America. Now, we did that within the Republican Party because, in large measure, because there was a diversity of view and a heated debate, so that when we came to the fore, we had something to come out with.
Well, do I understand you to be saying that the diversity within the Republican Party that permitted Republican sponsorship of a civil rights bill to which the Democratic Party was presumptively opposed shows what?
It shows, I think, that that debate is results in some positive thinking, in some positive action, which is important to the country and which the country really adopted,
well,
and to which the country responded.
Why couldn't that debate have taken place anyway? Are you saying that Hubert Humphrey was not in favor of civil rights in 1962?
I'm saying that as much as Hubert Humphrey devoted much of his efforts to civil rights, he did not, in fact, take that initiative in 1961. You recall that President Kennedy, as a part of his campaign, had said that the first bill he would introduce or would have introduced was a civil rights bill. Mm-hmm. His whole first year came and went without that happening. And it was not until the Republicans moved, as a result of a good deal of intra-party discussion, that particular plug was pulled.
Now, what then happened was that the civil rights bills are carried largely under the impetus of the Democratic Party, am I correct? For instance, specifically, Senator Goldwater opposed the 64 bill on constitutional grounds.
But in fact, it was Senator Dirksen in the Senate who provided the vital ingredient at that point in the process. It began with the Republicans in the House. It succeeded because of Senator Dirksen in the Senate.
Well, I mean, the anomalies are endless. The principal juridical opponent of Brown versus Board of Education had been nominated for President of the United States by the Democratic Party a generation earlier, right? Now, what do we do with this except ask ourselves the following question? In the last analysis, if we're going to have an effective competitive situation between the parties, there has got to be a point at which an individual is a misfit so long as he labels himself a member of one party when he so clearly is identified with the inclinations of the other. I give you, as an example, our friend from Oregon, what's his name? The late, you know what I mean? Morse, yeah, Wayne Morse.
Wayne Morse,
across the aisle,
did that as a matter of his inner motion. He did it. He became an independent for a while, and then he finally became a Democrat. And that was the result of his conscience, his inner urging. Bob La Follette, at an earlier period, went through the same agonies. Long before he finally left the Republican Party, he announced that he wanted to continue to work within the party, to work with the party, where the party was wrong, to correct it. Where it was right, he would support it. So these are not new problems, but there is a new element in these problems today, and this is what I think we have to get at. And that new element is the hit list technique. When Wayne Morse left the party, he did it as an act of personal statement. Bob La Follette's very personal wrestlings with the, with his position.
When you say that personal, are you saying that you would have thought it dastardly for a conventional Republican to oppose him in the Republican primary?
No, no, I'm all for primaries. And primaries are important. And there are some tough primaries going on around the country right now, which are viewed as a sort of test between the right and the left within the Republican Party. But what I'm talking about is when organizations are developed, they're not official Republican organizations in many cases. They are informal, but they are largely consist of very conservative Republican members. They go out, they collect money. They at least leave the impression with people who contribute this money that it's going to be spent somewhere in a Republican cause. Probably the understanding that it'll be a conservative Republican cause.
Yeah.
They sit there like spiders in the middle of the web, and they look around for targets of opportunity, and it may be a primary in Illinois, or a primary in New Jersey, or it may be a Democratic primary. They don't always restrict themselves to Republican situation. But they are letting the ideology, which motivates their operation, control all other loyalties.
What's wrong with that? What's wrong with that?
What's wrong with it is that it's breaking down the two-party system in the United States. That's what's wrong with it.
Well, exactly the contrary can be maintained, that it is reviving it. Incidentally, I've been receiving...
It can be maintained, but it...
I've been receiving solicitations for 30 years from a thing called the Committee for an Effective Congress, the sole purpose of which is to collect money to give to liberals who are fighting conservatives, whether Republicans or Democrats. Now, all of a sudden, the conservatives have come up with called the Committee for a Free Congress, and everybody's just flipping at the notion that conservatives should exercise the same civil rights as liberals. It's just not fair.
I hope you contributed freely to the Committee for an Effective Congress.
Well, of course I didn't. I made a living denouncing them.
But they never implied that they were a party organization. They never implied.
No, they were bipartisan.
They were bipartisan.
No, they said, we're against conservatives anywhere.
They contributed to such radical Republicans as Thurston Martin.
They would always contribute to the leftward most in any alternative situation. And Thurston Martin fitted that bill on that particular occasion, but it seems to me that there is this newfound indignation among American liberals at the notion that Americans also should be allowed to use the techniques which they have just happened upon, which have been really quite widespread, as used by Cope, for instance, in behalf of labor unions. The idea of a hit list was popularized, at least in my memory, in 1950. Everybody who voted for the Taft-Hartley bill was to be eliminated from the American political scene. And all of organized labor and all of its janissaries were mobilized to that high end. Now, it didn't work, as it happened, but the notion that a bunch of American Washington fascists have discovered something brand new is itself kind of amusing.
One of the reasons it didn't work was because it was all out there. You can see it. But what's happening now is not all out there. These committees are relatively unidentifiable in many ways.
Really?
They don't tell who their targets are going to be. They don't tell the contributors for whom they ask money where that money's going to be spent. They give some sort of implication that it's going to be spent in Republican causes. It may end up in a Democratic primary in Pennsylvania.
It's an ipsa res loquitur situation. They are saying, we're against anybody who votes for the following 10 things. Who votes to inflate the currency, who votes for the Panama Canal treaties. I happen to be against my fellow conservatives on that particular issue. but they choose to make it this season's cause militant.
There is another new element in this thing this year that I didn't observe. Fritz, that you started our conversation by recalling the events of 1964.
Yeah.
Senator Goldwater was scrupulous as the leader of the Republican Party in not subscribing to any hit list activity. He felt that a Republican incumbent, for
example... That's not 100% true. He endorsed me when I ran against John Lindsay as a conservative for mayor in 1965. Well, Lindsay was a Republican.
But in 64, when he was the presidential nominee, to my knowledge, he did not undercut any Republican candidate.
You wouldn't expect him to do that. In the first place,
he didn't do it. I wouldn't expect him to, and he didn't.
In the first place, he was head of the Senate re-election committee. I heard him booed by 5,000 conservatives when he was asked the question, was he supporting Javits for re-election? And he's sort of holding his nose. He said yes.
But he said yes. But he said yes. Whereas, for
instance,
today...
Everybody understood that it was a formalistic duty, like you supporting...
Today, Clifford Case is being criticized by other Republicans who come out of this with this hit list...
aren't you suggesting that there is some supreme law that should protect Clifford Case from Republican opposition in the primaries?
I'm not suggesting it. I'm saying that if you want to have a Republican Party which has more than 18% of the national electorate, that Republicans who have some position of leadership in the party don't go around endorsing the Republicans out of state. Let me make this clear. Anybody in New Jersey can do anything they want. They can nominate Cliff Case. They can not nominate him. They can elect him in the general election. They can defeat
him. They can go for Jeff Bell.
But when you have groups who bring in money and influence at random from all of the points of the compass, I think that's changing the game, and I think it's changing the game in an adverse way.
Excuse me, I disagree with you for very fundamental reasons. I disagree with you because under the American Constitution, you have got to have a seat in a specified location where you live. In England, it's very different. They'll assign you a safe seat.
Well, this means that
for instance, a perfectly innocent resident of Connecticut, was stuck.
There'd be those who challenge that
was
statement.
Was stuck with Senator Fulbright from Arkansas. Writing my foreign policy for me for 12 disastrous years, during which we lost most corners of the globe. Now, I consider under the circumstances that it would be a dereliction of duty for me not to contribute to a fund to defeat Bill Fulbright, even though he lives in the notion that I should only use my resources to defeat people in Fairfield County, Connecticut, is absolutely naive.
Fine. If you, as a citizen of Fairfield County, Connecticut, want to contribute to somebody's campaign in Arkansas, I see no problem with that. But
you just did. You saw the problem with Clifford Case.
No, it's a different situation. Number one, you are not the titular leader of the Republican Party. You're not at this moment. You may be someday.
Will you have crossed the aisle at that point?
I think we'll have both traveled a lot by the time we get to that point. what we have
here... I might be president of Panama first.
What we have here is a situation where an organization goes not into Fairfield County, Connecticut, but say into Tucson, Arizona, and spreads the word...
Against Goldwater.
No. That they're going to evangelize this country in favor of conservative Republicans, and they don't specify who you're going to contribute to. They just, it's a murky kind of a situation. And that fun, and maybe they don't even know at that moment. They sit back and wait for a target of opportunity which is disruptive of normal Republican practices in this country.
I really fail to understand that. When some evangelist comes along to me and says, will you contribute to missionary work in Africa? I don't insist on recording the sins that have been piled up by individual beneficiaries of my munificence. I simply assume that there is a general situation there that needs improving. And if I'm asked to contribute to a fund for spreading the conservative gospel, I understand myself to be engaged in high patriotic activity. And I don't see why you'd fail to follow that point.
Even when that means killing off the people who will help to provide the Republican Party with the strength in the United States House of Representatives so that we may elect a speaker and we may be able to appoint the chairman of the committees, when it means knocking off the people who may be contribute to an aggregate of strength in the Senate.
Senator, don't you understand your difficulty? Your difficulty is that it's been running your way for the last generation. And look what you people have done to the Republican Party. It practically doesn't exist.
Well, I don't think it was running our way.
We didn't have
I don't think it was running our way.
The things that you've just recognized as starting now.
I don't think you could say it was running our way in 1964 when Nelson Rockefeller wasn't even allowed to address the Republican convention. It wasn't running our way at that moment in this.
You know why he wasn't allowed to
address it? Well, no, wait a
minute. Because he called them all fascists the day before.
It wasn't.
What
about the 76 convention when Jack Javits wasn't allowed to address the Republican convention?
Well, I think that Jack Javits was considered in Kansas City as somebody who was Republican opportunistically. Now, you may say that you may say I'm saying that because he declined to come out for my brother, who was a sitting Republican conservative senator at the time. But that's not true.
And who had not come out for Senator Javits.
Correct. Correct. As a matter of high principle. But Javits refused to come out for Goldwater in 64. Now, Kansas City was a meeting.
That was a little tit for tat, I think. I don't know who was tit and who was tat.
It's not a clean victory because you see, in Kansas City, all the people who were for Ford promised to go for Reagan if he won, and all the people who were for Reagan promised to go for Ford, but Javits didn't. So under the circumstances, when Javits got up to speak, quite apart from the fact that manifestly he had very little to say, if you read the text, they wanted to express their displeasure. By the way, I heard you on a program in which you expressed your utter contempt for the way in which the Republicans conducted themselves in 1976. Would you care to elaborate on that?
Your memory is better than mine.
This was on a program called Black Perspective on the News.
Oh, yes, I do have utter contempt. Bob Dole tells me, with some regret, that he was not scheduled for a single meeting with a black audience as vice presidential candidate. I think the Republicans did conduct a campaign which ignored that 20% of the American population, the black Americans, people who have a traditional basis of allegiance with the Republican Party, who voted as a result of that campaign 94% for President Carter. And yeah, I think that was a loss.
Senator,
that was a loss which we can attribute in large measure to neglect in that campaign.
Well, you may.
And I am. I think it is contemptible.
I renew that position. It's not contemptable if.
Yes,
if,
just to if, ignore a 20%
wait
of
a
your
minute.
Population.
It's not contemptible if your motives are perfectly reasonable. If you turn yourself over to a campaign manager. And your name is Arafat, and it is suggested that you spend half of your time touring synagogues in New York City, and you say, "Gosh, I don't think so. I think I'll go and try my luck elsewhere." This strikes me as a reasonable political decision. the fact that 98% of American Negroes voted for Carter is something that was anticipated by most strategists.
It didn't have to be. It didn't have to happen.
Well,
I carry, as a Republican, the majority in black precincts in the center of the city of Baltimore.
Because you're so Democratic, that's why.
No, no, but that is not so. I go there and I ask them for their vote.
Listen, Senator, going in, Carter was ahead by 34 points. He won by 1 point. So whoever managed four didn't make that many mistakes.
Well, yeah.
The only reason Carter is president of the United States is because he got the votes of the people who went for Goldwater in the Sun Belt in 1964, another one of our paradoxes. But let's introduce our examiner, Mr. Charles Cordray, is the distinguished military affairs correspondent for the Baltimore Sun, who has been before on this program, and we now submit to you, Mr. Cordray.
Thank you. Senator, you got off a phrase that there is a new spirit, but you didn't get a chance to elaborate on it because of an interruption. What is this new spirit?
Well, I think it's a spirit of exclusionism. It's a spirit.
It's not a favorable new spirit.
No, I'm afraid that there is that spirit. Now let me say this: that the worst thing that President Carter may do to the Republican Party is to fade so fast himself that we don't work out within the Republican Party some of these problems that I think do exist. And he may present us with opportunities so soon that we fail to address ourselves, I think, to our own internal difficulties.
What are some?
Well, I think
what
this
is he going to do wrong?
I think this spirit of exclusionism.
I mean the opportunities that you're going to get from the Democrats.
Well, I think there are obvious problems. The inflation, the weakness of the dollar is an enormous concern to almost every American. I think the taxes are concerning almost every American. The latest polls show that about 75% of the people have reached the real limit of toleration on taxes, and more that are going to feel that way by the 15th of April.
Did you vote for the increase in the Social Security tax?
No.
You did not.
Congratulations. How would you have funded the deficit?
Well, I think you had to address the deficit. You've got a demographic problem. I think the limits that were set in that bill were just simply too high.
Senator, in your letter of regarding your letter of last November, has it done any good? That's any perceptible good? You got
yes,
a response from Mr. Brock that he was going to open the doors. What doors have opened? Who's come in?
I think it did some good. I think it gave Bill Brock an opportunity to exercise a little more flexibility than he would otherwise have done. I think it gave him a little more operating space. I would hope that his efforts to talk to people like Jesse Jackson were in part at least supported, perhaps did not initiate it, but supported by that letter. Now, I am under no illusions that inviting Jesse Jackson to breakfast is going to bring about a renewed interest in the Republican Party on the part of black Americans. I think there has to be some evidence that there is a community of interest. And of course, this gets back to what Bill Buckley has been suggesting. But I think there is that community of interest, and I think it can be demonstrated.
He suggested, as I wrote it down here, that you must be a Democrat because you carry the black precincts of Baltimore. Did you mean that?
I don't remember saying that, but my impression is that Senator Mathias wins victory after victory to a substantial extent because he attracts Democratic support.
Well, let me say first
of all. In fact,
I
think you have to do that. And it's like Reagan in California. If he didn't attract a lot of Democrats, he
in Maryland, win. In Maryland, you couldn't win without many Democratic friends.
That's right.
A simple question of arithmetic.
Yeah.
But let me say that the reasons I win, I think, Or primarily because...
I mean, apart from your beautiful blue eyes.
Well, more my beautiful wife, who is the best, much better campaigner than I. But I think both of us go to a black community or to a white community, and of whatever character, and making a personal appeal.
What do you tell them at the black community?
I tell them what is the fact, that I have a concern about the condition.
Minimum wage bills, rates, so that you can help unemployment?
A question of personal concern with the condition in which you find them is, I think, the most important thing. And the generation of a feeling between you that that there is some mutuality of interest.
Yeah, but that's really rather unspecified, isn't it?
Of course it's unspecified.
Yeah, I appeared before the Committee of 100 black leaders in New York when I ran for mayor, and they said to me, what will you do for Negroes specifically if you get elected for mayor? And I said, nothing. Absolutely nothing. I would insist on an impartial application of justice. And I am associated with a party that has done more, in my opinion, for upward mobility than any party in the history of the United States. And I should think, as long as we have upward mobility, your prospects are increased. But I didn't get many votes.
Didn't you say you would have asked for a recount if you had won? Were you the one who said that?
Not to them.
No, later.
That wasn't a prospect.
It seems to me you've both been discussing a lot of Republican Party problems which suggest that these things go on while the Democrats go merrily along their way, picking up votes. How will you get more than 1 in 20? Would you both take that question? How will you get more than 1 in 20 to admit he is a Republican?
Well, I think the first target I would have, I assume that your question means how would you improve the ratio, the first target has got to be young people. I am really devastated by the fact that only about 15% of the young people of America will admit that they are Republicans.
Yeah, but more young people voted for Ford than for Carter. That's not a bad sign, is it?
Well, that's perhaps the first hopeful sign. And I think there has to be an effort made to find out what is on the minds of the young people in America. And to express it, well, why limit that to the young people of America, after all?
Well, no, but I mean, the only reason I reacted a little bit to this is that I've heard so many people act sycophantic towards young people, and I really don't believe that it fools them, or B, that they want it.
Well, it isn't a question of acting sycophantic. It's a question that, if you've got 18% of the electorate today, mm-hmm. and you're only attracting 15% of the young voters, you aren't even going to be able to maintain the low level at which we now are.
I know, and maybe you should say to the young voters, you know why we're not attracting more of you? Because you're too dumb to understand mm-hmm. that you can't get something for nothing. Have you ever tried that?
Yes. And in some cases, I think it is effective to absolutely be candid with people, yeah. and it is a helpful thing. But the difficulty is that we are now so thin as a party. It's not that you can't come within 1% of the presidency. Mm-hmm. That can happen. You can even win a Senate seat in a Democratic state. That can happen. But mounting a campaign is increasingly difficult. People who are in practical, everyday politics are finding it tougher to get the campaigns going for state legislators, for county executives, for boards of aldermen. You can't find the fundraisers, you can't find the precinct workers, and this is where the party is now really beginning to hurt. And if we're hurting now, where we still have some momentum, still have a reservoir of manpower, it's going to be very difficult in another 5 or 10 years.
What's the hurt? You raise far more money than the Democrats do.
In some,
the $5
bill. Categories, mm-hmm. but tougher on the home front. That's the Republican Congressional Committee, for example, is extremely successful. but it's done on a highly institutionalized and professional basis. The personal candidates are having a tougher time these days.
Buckley, do you believe the Democratic Party is perceived in the country as the party that promises everything to everybody?
Yeah.
How do you think the Republican Party is perceived? May I just follow that beforehand? Is Senator Mathias suggesting that the Republican Party get on board with the same sort of idea?
I think the Republican Party is widely conceived as a party primarily interested in business, misanthropic in a undifferentiated kind of a way, not very enthusiastic even about its own dogmas, opportunistic in turning to the government to bail itself and its institutions out when they get into difficulty, on the whole unprincipled, and under the circumstances roughly disdainful. It has a single strength. More Americans, I think of it as a party attached to realism than think of the Democratic Party that way. They do believe that the Republican Party is capable of exercising certain restraints which are strategically profitable.
Now, do you think Senator Mathias' philosophy would bring remarkable changes in
absolutely not. No, Senator Mathias's philosophy, as it vibrates into me, is one that tends to look at the Democratic platform as something that we ought to emulate in order to become convincing Republicans. I find a certain paradox there. Okay. I think we should be much more imaginative and self-confident in the Republican Party in order to attract a wider clientele.
Senator, how many seats are the Republicans going to lose because of votes on the Panama Canal treaties? Bluntly to a question
that's,
mark.
That's if a any. Crystal ball that I don't have.
Any, do you think?
It's conceivable. It's possible. It's an emotional issue. It may not go away. I think we don't know at this moment how the final votes will be cast on the canal.
No, but we know that the leader of your party in the Senate is how he's going to cast his, and that he can't carry all the Republicans along with him, apparently.
That's right.
There's one question I don't want to let fall here, Mr. Buckley. Fulbright wrote our foreign policy for 12 years. You can't really mean that. Fulbright is among the most frustrated men in the...
Everything I say is exaggerated, I think it is as close to being the truth as anything that can be said about anybody. Remember, he voted for the Tonkin Bay Resolution. And it was much, much, much later that he formulated his opposition to the Vietnam War.
No. I wanted to ask, have I time for another question?
Yes, sir.
I wanted to ask Senator Mathias about a rather long sentence here in the letter to Mr. Brock.
Don't quote the whole sentence.
I shall not. I shall just pick out the business here about the Republicans initiating social reforms and promoting sound fiscal management. And I think we could stipulate that not everybody agrees that the Republicans have done either of those in recent times. We had our highest deficits under the last Republican administration until we got the present one. Isn't that true?
That is unfortunately true.
Who's promoting this sound fiscal management?
I think there is a greater chance of sound fiscal management with a Republican administration and with the Republican Party. At least it's a goal. Sometimes we don't make the goal, but we keep the goal out there.
But there's no, it doesn't compare with Carter's goal of balancing the budget. But I suppose nobody really thinks it's, you don't think he can do it, do you?
I'm, I wish that he
in
could.
In his first term?
I wish that he could.
Thank you very much, Senator Mathias. Thank you very much, Mr. Cordray, the Baltimore Sun. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Printed bound transcript of this program, send $1 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. Indicate the subject of the program and please allow 3 weeks for delivery. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content. Funding was provided by this station and by other public television stations.